Well, if you turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5, and we're going to read verses 18 through 21, just a couple of short verses. So Ephesians 5, and starting at verse 18. So Paul writes this to the Ephesian Christians. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Will you pray with me now? Lord God Almighty, we trust that, Lord, these words we have just read are inspired words, words that are breathed out by you, and words that you intended to use to change us and to transform us to be more and more like the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, Father, as we consider this topic this evening, we do pray and ask, Lord, that you would lead us into greater maturity in the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that you would shape us so that as a community of your people, we would be increasingly characterized by deep roots in your word, by warm hearts in your love, and by active hands in your service. And we pray that you would do this for your own glory. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, a number of years ago now, there was a man living in Indiana in the States. And this man was playing a board game with some of his friends. And part of this board game was trivia about pieces of art. And he noticed that one of the pieces of art that this board game was talking about looked very similar to an old painting that he had hanging up in his kitchen, covering an old hole. And so, intrigued, he went on the internet and he looked into it and he got in contact with a gallery. And it turned out that this piece of artwork, which had been hanging in his kitchen for years on end, was actually a masterpiece, a hidden masterpiece, by an American painter of the 20th century. And the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston ended up buying this painting off this man for $1.25 million. Now, this priceless painting had been covering the hole in the wall for years. It was familiar, overlooked, undervalued. Now, the sort of thing that you see every day, but fail to appreciate its true worth. And really, that's what we want to be thinking through this evening. Why do we sing psalms as part of our worship in Reformed churches? Is it simply an outdated tradition from the past? Or is it actually a hidden treasure? A familiar, overlooked, but worth its weight in gold? And in my thinking, anyway, it's not a simple question to answer. If we're honest with ourselves, quite often the psalms are hard to sing. Some of them are quite unusual. Many of them feel quite culturally removed from our own context. Now, there's a line from one of the psalms in our green Sing to the Lord book that goes like this. It says, "Rebuke the beasts from Egypt's reeds, the bulls with calves from every land. May they with shame their tribute bring." Doesn't that just pull on your heartstrings? I mean, what does that even mean? I'd never really sung psalms until I entered a Reformed church. As you may well know, most other churches don't sing psalms. And especially to start with, I found that singing the psalms was hard work, and it felt like hard work with diminishing returns. And so for a number of years, I've been trying to think through, actually, why do we do this as churches? Should we do this? Does it matter? Does it not matter? And really, my goal this evening is not primarily to convince you that we ought to sing psalms, although I do believe that, but instead to provoke you to think, to question, to consider what the Bible has to say on this issue. So there are three reasons why I now believe in singing the psalms. And the first of them is that the Bible calls for it. The Bible calls for it. So if you look with me at these verses that we've just read together from Ephesians chapter 5, it's not that easy to see in the English, but really the central verb or the central command in these verses is in verse 18, where it says, "Be filled with the Spirit." Now that's what these verses are all about. That instead of being filled and influenced by alcohol, the Ephesian Christians are to be filled and influenced and controlled by the presence and power of the Holy Spirit in their lives. And if you look down, there are five consequences or five results of being filled with the Spirit. And verse 19, it talks about addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody. Verse 20, giving thanks. And verses 21, submitting to one another. And really the point of this is that that is what Spirit-filled people do. They sing joyfully to the Lord. They give thanks in every circumstance. They submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And as a side note, it's a bit of a challenging list, isn't it? And I wonder what it says about your life and what it says about my life. And here we're going to be mainly focusing in on verse 19. And if you look at that verse again with me, you'll see that Paul uses very specific words to describe this Spirit-filled singing, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. We might remember from those verses that we read together in Colossians that it uses the exact same phrases, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your heart to God. So there's at least a sense in these verses in which Paul is not only calling believers to joyful congregational singing, but actually he's telling them what to sing. Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. You might find yourself thinking, well, that's fine. Jim, you can take your psalms. We'll take the hymns and spiritual songs. But it's not quite that simple. And the reason is that actually all three of these words were actually terms that were used to describe the psalms. So if you flick with me to Psalm 76, Psalm 76, and the header of that psalm says this, "To the choir master with stringed instruments, a psalm of Asaph, a song." And in the Greek version of the Hebrew Old Testament called the Septuagint, are those three terms, stringed instrument, a psalm and a song, are actually the exact same words as psalm, hymn, and spiritual song used here in our passage in Ephesians. So Paul chooses these words very intentionally. And just to be completely clear, I'm not saying that we should only sing psalms. There are some Christians who say that. I disagree. I think that's wrong. I think that goes beyond what this text is saying. Actually, those words, hymns and spiritual songs, in Greek and Roman context, could also refer to songs that have been recently written. But while I'm saying that it doesn't call for the exclusive singing of the psalms, it's hard to avoid the conclusion that it does call for us to sing psalms as well as other songs as part of our Spirit-led and Spirit-driven worship. And really, this is a point that I want you to come away from the sermon with. And not primarily that we must sing the songs, but instead that by not singing the psalms, we deprive ourselves of a rich gift that God has given us. So why is this important? Well, it's important because what we sing shapes us. It shapes us as we sing it together in the context of corporate worship, and it shapes us as we find ourselves humming it to ourselves throughout the week. Now, there's an old saying that goes, "We are what we sing." In the 1700s in Scotland, there was a political activist by the name of Andrew Fletcher, and quite famously, he once said, "Let me write the songs of a nation, and I don't care who writes its laws. Let me write the songs of a nation, and I don't care who writes its laws." Because we are what we sing. That's true as nations, and it's true as churches as well. So the first reason I believe in psalm singing is because the Bible calls for it. And the second is that the Spirit intends it. The Spirit intended it. One of the most important considerations whenever we are interpreting the Bible, whether from the pulpit or in home groups or in our own homes, is the idea of literary genre. That there are different kinds of literature. You don't read a tweet the same way as you read a news report. You don't read a detective novel the same way you read a cookbook. And the same is true for the Bible. You don't read the book of Jonah the same way that you read the book of Romans. One is a story and a narrative. The other is a carefully constructed argument. It changes the way that you read it and experience it. You see, the Holy Spirit could have just given us a book of rules, or just a story, or just a really long poem. But instead, he reveals the glory of Christ through all these different kinds of literature together. And this is where the Psalms come in. And it's a very simple but important point, which is that Psalms are songs. They're not sermons. They're not prophecies. And they're not even primarily prayers. But instead, they are songs. And as songs, they were meant to be sung. For example, I'm a very big Johnny Cash fan. I love Johnny Cash. And one of his most well-known songs that you may well have heard is a remake of Hurt that he recorded shortly before his death. And in many ways seems to sum up his life. And the song goes like this. It goes, "I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become, my sweetest friend? Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt." But although these words can be moving to read, without the music and the form of a song, you miss something. You still get the content, but you miss the emotion. And so without hearing it in its intended medium, you get a truncated version. You miss something. And actually the same is true of the Psalms. Are they wonderful to read? Of course they are. Can they be a fantastic guide to your prayers? Absolutely. But their first and primary purpose was to be sung corporately. Originally in the temple and the synagogue, and now in the context of God's gathered people today. And so by failing to sing the Psalms, we actually miss the Spirit's intent in giving us these words in this specific genre. To sing the Psalms is to seek to be true to the Holy Spirit's intention. And part of the way this works really has to do with the nature of songs and of music. That the fact that they're given to us in the form of songs should indicate to us something about their nature. Mick Jacoby, the lead singer from Sons of Korah, who have put many of the Psalms to song, put it like this. Music is the language of the heart, and it was for this language that the Psalms were written. You see, singing doesn't just convey emotions, but instead it draws you into the emotions. And so when you stop and think about it, isn't it astounding that we literally have a collection of songs that were inspired by the Holy Spirit? So this is how the old reformer John Calvin put it. He said, "Even after we have searched everywhere, we will not find a better nor a more appropriate set of songs than the songs of David, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And for that reason, when we sing them, we are assured that, as it were, God himself puts the words into our mouth, as if he himself were singing through us for his own glory." You see, one of the aspects of the Holy Spirit's ministry in our lives is to reveal Christ. That just like a floodlight that shines on an old building, illuminating it, drawing our eyes to it. And that's what the Holy Spirit does through the Scriptures. He draws us to Christ. And that's what the Holy Spirit does through the Psalms. Do you know that the book of Psalms is the most quoted book of the Old Testament in the New Testament? Why is that? It's because the Psalms are full of Jesus. That just like overripe tomatoes, when you squeeze them, how they ooze Jesus. How they anticipate him. They describe him. How they lead us to him. And Psalm 110 and verse 4, it says, "The Lord has sworn and will not change. You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." That's the high priesthood of Jesus, which we thought about last week. In Psalm 69 and verse 21, it says, "For my thirst they gave me sour wine to drink." That's the cross. In Psalm 16 and verse 10, it says, "For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, or let your Holy One see corruption." That's the resurrection. And it's not just the overtly messianic Psalms, but actually every one of the Psalms tells a gospel-shaped story. It reveals some aspect of what God is like and what Jesus Christ has come to accomplish. Each Psalm has something to teach us about what it means to live under the reign of King Jesus. So the second reason I believe in singing the Psalms is that the Spirit inspired this portion of the Bible as a collection of songs to be sung. Which leads to the final reason, which is because our churches need it. Because our churches need it. And really, this is where the rubber hits the road. That it's not only that our churches ought to sing psalms, but actually that the failure to sing the psalms deprives the church of something valuable. That we should do it not just because we ought, but actually because the spiritual health of our churches require it. And part of this comes down to actually how uncomfortable some of the psalms are to sing. And there's a whole range of reasons for this. I'm more than happy to admit that sometimes the reason they're hard to sing is because the words and the tunes are outdated, archaic, hard to sing. But I suspect that at other times, the reason is actually because we love different things than what the psalm writers loved. So for example, in Psalm 119 and verse 20, it says, my soul is consumed with longing for your laws at all times. And that's uncomfortable to sing. Because as we sing it, we recognize our own shortcomings. We recognize that often we're consumed with longing for happiness. Often we're consumed with longing for possessions or for money. But that seldom are our hearts consumed with longings for God's law. You see, when we sing the Psalms, we're often confronted with the reality that things that the psalm writers lament, we don't care about. And things that the psalm writers love don't move us. And in that sense, every psalm accomplishes something of a heart surgery, that they analyze, they dissect our hearts, our desires, our fears, our longing. They diagnose false loves and false idols that are in our hearts. They retrain our hearts to love the right thing. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. But perhaps the most pressing reason why the church needs the Psalms is what they teach us about true biblical spirituality. It can be sometimes easy to come away from a church service with the idea that a healthy Christian looks like somebody who is always confident, always trusting, and never doubting, and never sad or discouraged. But the Psalms blast that out of the water. I think the band Casting Crowns once called it a stained glass masquerade. Did you know that approximately half the Psalms are laments? Are there songs that are all about feeling sad, feeling unhappy, feeling doubt, feeling tormented, feeling broken? When I was growing up, there was one band that young teenage guys, including myself, used to love, and it was called Linkin Park. It was a metal band that in many ways expressed the futility of life and how hard life can be. And some of the words of the more well-known songs go like this. "Are crawling in my skin, these wounds they will not heal. Fear is how I fall, confusing what is real. I tried so hard and got so far, but in the end it doesn't even matter." And they were words that struck a chord with people. The lead singer, Chester, was interviewed in the year 2017, and he said these words. He said, "I have a hard time with life. I don't like my mind. I'm stuck inside it 24 hours a day." And a few months after the interview, he tragically committed suicide. You see, we're living in a world that is crying out for authenticity, after the acknowledgement that actually everything isn't okay. Everything isn't just one big, exciting street party. But if all we sing in our churches are happy, triumphalistic songs about how great life is, then we actually convey that there is no place in our churches for the broken, for those who experience that actually life is not okay. You see, the beautiful thing about the Psalms is that they teach us that it's okay to feel sad, to go through hard times, and to feel like God isn't there. In Psalm 88 and verse 14, it says this, "O Lord, why do you cast my soul away? Why do you hide your face from me?" You see, the Psalms are divine songs that are written for broken people in a broken world. And don't we need that? In fact, maybe you need to be reminded of that this evening. That it's okay to feel sad. It's okay to feel lonely. It's okay to feel like you're not coping right now. That's exactly who the church is for broken, struggling people who are trusting in a gentle and all-sufficient Saviour. You see, that's what the Psalms express, and that is what Jesus is like. So how are we supposed to respond to this? And in a sense, it's a little bit like preaching to the converted, in the sense that actually we are already a church that does sing the Psalms, kind of whether you like it or not. So maybe a better question is, how do we best benefit from this? And really it's the same principles as with any other songs, and like we talked about this morning, the idea of singing with understanding. Think about the words of the Psalms that you're singing. Use the words that you sing to express your emotions before God. Look for Jesus Christ and His all-sufficiency to be your Saviour in the Psalms that you sing. But perhaps most pressingly, it's not a how-to guide on how to sing the Psalms, but instead just learning to appreciate what a rich gift it is that God has given to us. And really, that's what I want you to come away with. With the sense that actually the Psalms are full of Jesus, that they shape us and mold us into healthy Christians, that they're made to be sung, and that they are God's gift to His church. Well, I want to finish with these words by the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer about the Psalms. He said this, whenever the Psalter, that is the book of Psalms, is abandoned, an incomparable treasure vanishes from the church. With its recovery will come unsuspected power. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we do thank you for the Psalms. We thank you, Lord, that every portion of your holy and inerrant word is your gift to us. Lord, you make no mistakes. And Father, we recognize that in the Psalms you have truly given us a rich gift. God, a collection of Spirit-inspired songs to be sung. And Father, we have experienced that in our own lives. That Father, as we sing your Psalms, Father, our hearts are moved and we are changed. So we thank you for that, and we pray that, Lord, you would help us to appreciate this precious gift that you've given us, and Lord, that you would do whatever it takes to make us into healthy, balanced, mature Christians. And we pray this for Jesus' sake. Amen.